Muy buenas noches, te saluda Genaro Lozano. Bienvenida, bienvenido a Foro Global, el programa de Foro TV especializado en temas internacionales. Es noche de viernes, noche de conversaciones globales, y en esta ocasión me acompaña Mamat Talibov. Él es el encargado de misión de la República de Azerbaiyán en México. Vamos a hablar sobre su país, sobre la relación con México, sobre, por supuesto, también los conflictos que hay en la región de esa parte de Asia Central y de muchos temas más. Así que ya lo sabes, no le cambies, esto es Foro Global. Empezamos después de la breve pausa. Gracias por estar esta noche con nosotros en Foro Global. Como te comentaba, se encuentra en el estudio Mamat Talibov. Él es el encargado de negocios de la Embajada de Azerbaiyán en México. Previamente se desempeñó como consejero político y jefe de misión adjunto de la Embajada de su país ante Estados Unidos y en la misión ante Naciones Unidas en Ginebra, Suiza. Es parte del Servicio Exterior Azerí desde el año 2000. Es egresado de Derecho Internacional de la Universidad Estatal de Bakú y maestro en Derecho Civil por la Universidad Otlar Yurdu de Azerbaiyán. Mamat, bienvenido a Foro Global. How are you?
Thank you. Muchas gracias. Agradezco mucho. Agradezco para su invitación. Thank you so much.
No, thank Great you. On the contrary, we're very happy to have you. I always start with personal questions, and in your case, it's going to be whatever I usually ask to any diplomat who's seated where you are right now. What made you decide to become a diplomat, and how did you end up being in Mexico, and how are you feeling here in this country?
Yeah, let me start with how I end up to be in the part of the Foreign Service. Actually, it basically was my childhood dream. And I grew up, my childhood I spent in Soviet Union, in the time of Soviet Union. And then I started to think about being in the Foreign Service and represent my country when I was like 9 or something, and represent my country, independent Azerbaijan, in the world. So, and let me also say that we, a couple of days ago, on 20th of January, we actually honored the memories of those who have sacrificed their lives during the 20 January 1990 events, when people of Azerbaijan stood against the Soviet dictatorship for the independence of the country. So that was the period when we were youngsters and the kids were thinking about that. And and I'm happy to be the Foreign Service the years after that, and, mm-hmm. and represent my country and represent my independent tricolor flag here in Mexico.
How was the transition from being a part of the Soviet Union, or the Soviet Empire, if you can call it that way, to become an independent country in Central Asia? How was it for you? You were very young by then.
Well, yes, but we, and I think that all of the Azerbaijanis that lived through that remember that perfectly, that it was a really difficult time. Azerbaijan went through injustices and went through many oppressions while striving to become once again in the history to get our democratic republic to become independent. And for us, it was a very difficult time because it was also not only because of the issues that were the case in the time in that period, but also about that we had a period when the aggression and the part of our neighbors has started, and the some events had occurred already. So that was really, really difficult period. Then when we became independent in 1991, the country was still very weak, the budget and the economy. And talking about the modern Azerbaijan, the development of the country Azerbaijan as we see today and we're proud of, it began with our national leader Heydar Aliyev when he became the head of the state in 1993. Mm-hmm. So because that we were on the verge of almost of the civil war, and we were having a war and having a military occupation of our territories from the neighboring country. So it was a really difficult period.
Mm-hmm. How is the relationship between Azerbaijan and the government of Vladimir Putin today, of Russia? Because you're in the middle of a region where there are major global players such as Turkey, Russia, and Iran. And you're right at the center of it, right at the center of major global powers. How is the relationship with Russia?
Well, Azerbaijan was always the country on the crossroads. So we're now, where West and East meets. Mm-hmm. And this also impacted what we have geopolitical today. But Azerbaijan also well known by its very good relations with its neighbors, because you know you Mexico have also a great neighbor, but which is big and strong, and also does Azerbaijan.
And we currently don't have a very good relationship with him.
Of course, with the neighbors you always have ups and downs. But we're happy to say that Azerbaijan also got this opportunity. To have a big friends is, as yesterday in the World Economic Forum said our president, Mr. Ilham Aliyev, that it's also an opportunity. The big markets, the opportunity to have good relations, to have balanced relations. The most important here is that these relations are in mutual respectful, and also take into account the national interest of the country. So without any interference on the internal affairs or something like this, so in mutual respect. So in that case, Azerbaijan has a very good relations with all the neighboring countries and having a strategic relations with some of them, I should say, except unfortunately the Armenian that continues to occupy the 20% of our territories. That's the case.
You also have a very special particularity about your population. You're mostly a Muslim country, but a very secular one, just like Turkey used to be. How do you manage to be such a secular country with such a religious population, with such a big chunk of the population being Muslim?
Well, we're proud of one thing which is really interesting. Azerbaijan this year is celebrating 100 years of the first Azerbaijan Democratic Republic. It's the first republic on the Muslim East, first republic ever in the world, so in the Muslim East. So we gave a right to vote to women back in 1918. You can imagine that it's ahead of many, many other countries of that period. It's beginning of the 20th century. And this perception of the Azerbaijani nation then, while creating this secular, independent, democratic republic with a parliament where different nationalities and people from different backgrounds presented. The inspiration, and by the way, we have the same flag today and the same anthem. So the inspiration was the modern, innovative understanding of equality. And I should also say that very recently, actually a couple of years ago, even the pontific Pope Francis I visited Azerbaijan. And and we're very proud of that too. He said that Azerbaijan is a model of the tolerant country. And of course, we have Muslim, both Sunni and Shia society, which are praying even together. We never had any problems. We have very vibrant Jewish population. Actually, the only Jewish settlement outside of Israel today that survived World War II is in Azerbaijan. So we also have Orthodox and Catholic Christians. So this is something that's coming from the inspirations that from the very ground of Azerbaijan. We're very proud of that.
You mentioned that you have very good relationship with Russia, with Iran, and with Turkey, with your neighbors. But you don't have a good relationship with Armenia. And recently the Armenian ambassador was here, and he gave his version of the conflict between your country and his. And you of course don't agree with what he said, and also with the version that he gave about Mexican legislators visiting a zoning conflict between the two countries.
Yeah, well, let me start with the conflict very shortly, because the audience of Mexico may be not that familiar about the conflict. The conflict there is the mere territorial claim of one country against another. It's there by the you know, we all know that Mexico is also one of the countries that are on the forefront of those who are supporting the international law and order and the sovereignty of each and every country and the territorial integrity. So this is here we're talking about aggression, military aggression by Armenia, and unfortunately 20% of the territory of Azerbaijan, which includes Nagorno-Karabakh region of Azerbaijan and also seven other regions that never been the part of Nagorno-Karabakh region. Occupied, and all the people, and it's about a million people, it's one out of seven at that period, at that epoch, the population of Azerbaijan has been expelled from that territory, so ethnically cleansed. So not a one single Azerbaijani now left in Armenia. There used to be more than 200,000, and more than 800,000 people of Azerbaijan citizens were expelled from the occupied territories of Azerbaijan in Azerbaijan proper. So, and we have an international community that took decision on that. We have, you know, the Security Council adopted four resolutions about unconditional an immediate withdrawal of all Armenian occupying forces from Azerbaijan in 1993, but it still stays on the paper, unfortunately. As to the Mexican deputies, actually, why I'm not, I of course obviously not agree with my Armenian colleague, because he said many things that was contradictory to himself, actually. Mm-hmm. And on the when you were asking him about visit of the Mexican deputies, and you were very rightly pointing out that they were visiting the territory of Azerbaijan, he said that it wasn't the territory of Azerbaijan. Well, actually, and then he said that there was a territory of a republic that's not recognized even by Armenia. So, well, it's illegal to visit these territories, and we said about that. So Mexican deputies visited the territory without knowing, probably it was a provocation by the Armenian government that was pretty strangely dragging the Mexican deputies who were visiting Armenia for the bilateral relations between Armenia and Mexico. But they dragged them and tried to demonstrate, to portray it as a support to the puppet regime, which is separatist regime supported by Armenia, and that they were surviving by the verge of the, and support by the Armenian government, have been contested, have been approved also by the European Court for Human Rights on that. Mm-hmm. So, and unfortunately, this was a case, and I think that here there were two main goals of Armenian government, and this is very unfortunate, because we have Azerbaijan is for the resolution of the conflict, resolution on the basis of international law, and also on the subjective and logic, you know, the negotiations that we need to have, based on the territorial integrity of the country. The issue was, the two goals were, first was to drag again and mislead the unfortunately legislators of Mexico, without even letting know the government of Mexico and the appropriate you know, institutions.
It was a major scandal in Mexico.
Yes, well, after the first this, just to drag them in order to ask, because they were trying to demonstrate that Mexico supports this puppet regime, which wasn't the case. And I do understand the frustrations of Mexican colleagues of mine. And at the same time, probably it was to damage the bilateral relations between Mexico and Azerbaijan, because probably it sits unhappiness in the Armenian government that we have booming relations with Mexico. Mm. In 2009, we have opened an embassy here. In 2014, Mexico opened the embassy in Baku.
Why don't you let me pause a little bit just to make a commercial pause, and then when we come back, we'll speak about the relationship between Azerbaijan and Mexico, because it's on its 28th anniversary, right? No, 25th anniversary of diplomatic relations.
Last year.
No te vayas, vamos a una pausa muy breve. Al regresar, continuaré con esta conversación con Mamá Matt Talibov, encargado de negocios de la Embajada de Azerbaiyán en México. No te vayas, no le cambies, esto es Foro Global. Gracias por continuar con nosotros en esta conversación global de viernes con Mamat Talibov, el encargado de negocios de la Embajada de Azerbaiyán en México. Mamad, we were talking about the Mexico-Azerbaijan relationship, and I was saying that it is its 25th anniversary of diplomatic relations. You were mentioning about the opening of a Mexican embassy here, and of course you being the chief of mission of your country in Mexico. What would you say characterizes the relationship between the two countries? You're a very rich country in oil. We don't have a trade relationship, and we're very far away. What unites Mexico and Azerbaijan?
Well, first it was actually the will of both parties to actually know each other more. Mm-hmm. We had relations before. Mexico recognized Azerbaijan in 1991. Mm-hmm. Then we, as you said, we just had diplomatic relations for 25 years. Last year we celebrated 25 years of our relations. We've opened an embassy here in 2009, and Mexico a couple of years after, in 2014, opened an embassy in Baku. I think that, we had a very good specter of relations in many areas. For example, we have a political consultation between two countries. We had a set of several rounds of consultation already. Mm-hmm. We had mutual visits of the officials, and my foreign minister actually visited Mexico as well. So also we're having the relations on the level of entrepreneurs. We just always try to invite and also have relations and have our entrepreneurs coming to Mexico for exploring the possibilities to invest and so on and so forth. As well as we have very good interparliamentary relations. We have a memorandum of understanding on both chambers. Mm-hmm. Actually, we have with Senate too. So we have really good relations with them as well. We have a very active group in Azerbaijan, the group of the friendship between Azerbaijan and Mexico and here. Mm-hmm. And we do appreciate that. This is important. As well as we're having very good relations and very, it's very interesting to see the growing relations on the sphere of culture. Because Azerbaijan, our part of the world, the South Caucasus, and Azerbaijan, has a very rich history. It's the place that has miracles and the, you know, interesting histories that many people were keen to discover, as well as Mexico. Mm. So as well, Mexico is also the country that is known by its multiculturality. You know, multicultural and having with a hospitality, as well as Azerbaijan. Mm. So probably because also all of that, we had the trade turnover for the last couple of years tripled. And also the level of the visits from Azerbaijan here and from here to Azerbaijan was also in the much higher level, like twice, I think increased twice. We're also working, and we're very interested to work to have a Mexican citizens coming to study for the universities in Azerbaijan, education exchanges too. Mm-hmm. And I should say that for the members of the non-aligned movement, I know that Mexico is observer. But the members of the non-aligned movement, we had a decree, presidential decree, mm-hmm. that is citizens of members of the non-aligned movement and providing them a scholarship, mm-hmm. full scholarship for education. So this also would bring, and also at the cultural level, we had a very interesting, especially last year, we had a very interesting Sonia Amelio, very well known Mexican choreographist, mm-hmm. went to Azerbaijan and presented the program. We had a program dedicated to the Frida Kahlo, mm. and her you know, her life and some of her biography. We're also having and in Mexico having an interchange of our, you know, national cuisines and the culture. So this is all very vibrant between the two.
You also have a soft spot for soft power. And if I may say, there are a lot of projects of architecture, of big names of architects like Zaha Hadid, who built a beautiful center in Baku. You also organize sports competitions and the Eurovision Festival. Would you say that Azerbaijan's soft power is actually that, the possibility of organizing this kind of cultural encounters between Europe and your country? Or what would you say it's Azerbaijan's most important soft power?
Well, about the soft power, if I may say so Azerbaijan's soft power would be our hospitality and our openness for the different cultures. Azerbaijan and Azerbaijan leadership were very consistent in our politics in the country of having inclusive society, mm. where many, many cultures, many people of many backgrounds are presented. And also we had, we're celebrating 10 years of the, marking 10 years of the Baku process, which is an interreligious dialogue forum, global forum, that is taking place in Azerbaijan every 2 years. So where many, many organizations, many, many representatives of the world coming together, and we're striving for the achieving and providing fora for the different representatives of different backgrounds to have a prospects and to see about the solidarity. You know, today we're having many concerns over things like xenophobia, and other things. But in Azerbaijan, we're trying to actually spread our model of the inclusive society and also see how we can get together different cultures and different representatives of the different cultures in Baku. So that will be. But you, of course, also mentioned the many other important events that has taken place in Baku. We had Formula One as Mexico. We had first European Games. Mm-hmm. And interestingly, last year we had fourth Islamic Solidarity Games. Mm-hmm. So this is the same country where you have a European Games, you have a Islamic Solidarity Games. And once again, it proves that we're bringing the many cultures together. And also, Azerbaijan just presented its candidature, Baku presented its candidature for the Expo 2025. Mm. So we're also hoping that that we will get this possibility to have this important event in Baku, and we will definitely. But I'm happy to hear that it's taken as a soft power of Azerbaijan. It's really sure. Good to hear that.
You also have a very famous first lady and vice president who represents a role model for many women in your country, I guess. And being a Muslim country and comparing the situation of women of Azerbaijan with the rest of the Muslim world, would you say that Azerbaijan, having such a strong presence of this first lady and vice president, do you think that she's a role model for the other women? And why does Azerbaijan include the participation of women in politics and this strong presence in a way?
Well, Azerbaijan was always, as I told you, Azerbaijan gave a right to vote to women in 1918. So strong and very active woman presence in Azerbaijan politics has always been the case. We have more than 25%, I think, presence of the in the parliament, for example. As to Madam Mehriban Aliyeva, our first vice president, she has always had her active involvement in both in internally and externally, especially on the things that are for the education or other important parts of the in Azerbaijan, as well as she was head of the Heydar Aliyev Fund, so she is president of the Heydar Aliyev Fund, and the Heydar Aliyev Fund implements many very important projects, not only in Azerbaijan but also all over the world, helping those in need to get the schools, the providing new facilities to the hospital in the hospitals, and helping those in need to get education, and also had a very very important project like building new schools and thousands and hundreds of new schools and other things like this. And I think this also being a very important person who playing that role and having this spreading this the image of a real compassion of a real Azerbaijani woman that are part of the very active part in the society, but also a mother and also as a being exposed. This is very important. I think that this spreads also the message in Azerbaijani society, and many, of course, want to be like her. And this also, many scenes like this, and also many, because of her kindness and her always help to many those in need. Actually, she was seen in Azerbaijan as one of the active person, one of the person who can give this. The possibility of having the hopes of many become true, become reality.
Yeah. We're approaching the end of the interview, and before that, I usually also go back to personal questions and, of course, of book recommendations. And I see that you're ready for it. You also brought a book by an Azerbaijan writer.
Yes. Yeah, it's a book of Kurban Said Aliyin. This is actually, and I mentioned this is a love story. Uh-huh. This is a love story of Azerbaijani Muslim and Orthodox Christian Georgian Nino, mm-hmm. Ali from Azerbaijan, Nino from Georgia. And this is not just a beautiful love story, but also it shows absolutely in details of all the hurdles that we went through during the creation of the first Azerbaijani democracy, first Muslim majority democracy in the world, and also the clashes of the different understanding and perceptions of different civilizations, and how it came in one synergy in Azerbaijan, and how we actually were striving. And unfortunately, this first republic lived just 23 months, but these 23 months gave a lot to the world, I think. And this is really fundamental, the really interesting and historical event. So these events, you can definitely live through this beautiful couple in this story, having more the personal story of this couple, and at the same time what has happened in the region.
That you part. Mentioned there's also a movie.
Yes, there's a movie too. Mm-hmm. There's a movie I think they had completed. Well, it was presented in 2016, Ali Nino movie of very famous director Kapadia. So, and I think that you would definitely enjoy this movie if you see that, and this is really good. But I will, of course, as always, as who would recommend you to read the book too.
Thank you so much for this minute for Foro Global. It's a pleasure having you here, and please feel welcome to come back anytime.
Thank you so much.
Gracias a ti por habernos acompañado esta noche en Foro Global. Soy Genaro Lozano. Te invito ahora a que continúes con la programación de Foro TV. Yo te espero el próximo lunes en punto de las 11 de la noche para una nueva emisión de Foro Global, y el domingo a las 11 para la mesa de debate de Sin Filtro. Por lo pronto, te deseo muy buen fin de semana.